So, Neeraj, the context is what Mr. Ajit Doval has said in Hyderabad, National Police Academy. He said that, fourth dimension of the war, that is basically civil society, subversion and the manipulation of civil society. He said it is the fourth dimension. Some people are talking it is actually the fifth dimension, but we will not go into that. But he says ke, that is going to be the वॉर विच इज गोइंग टू बी फॉट, बिकॉज एक्चुअल फिजिकल वॉर जो पहले लड़ा जाता था वो तो अभी बड़ी कॉस्टली हो गया, और आजकल जो ऑप्शंस अवेलेबल हैं वो इस तरह के ऑप्शंस अवेलेबल हैं, आप किसी भी कंट्री की जो सिविल सोसाइटी है उसको इन्फ्लुएंस कर सकते हो, मैनिपुलेट कर सकते हो, सबवर्ट कर सकते हो. एंड ही हैज गार्डेड द नेमली दोज आईपीएस ऑफिसर्स हु आर गोइंग टू गो टू द फील्ड नाउ आफ्टर दिस पासिंग आउट परेड. ही told them that they have to be very very careful and they have to provide the leadership. Now the point which is coming is कि after all ये जो civil society है, suddenly they are up in arms, कि ये अजीत डोवल ने civil society के against में क्या बोल दिया, और ऐसा क्या हो गया कि civil society ने ऐसा क्या कर दिया कि are they subverted, are they influenced or manipulated against the country? So, basically they are taking a very serious offense against the statement of Mr. Doval. So that is the context which I am setting for you. Or this is, please enlighten us on
See,
this issue.
when we talk of civil society, we generally refer to the organizations and groups which have a common interest and do collective activities. This is the general definition, but civil society refers to the NGOs or the non-governmental organizations. And if they are feeling agitated and if they are feeling a little let down, that is rightly so. Because elements of civil society have been engaged in subversive activities in India. And what Mr. Doval has clearly said is, as a message to the police officers who are the law enforcers, that implementation, the passing of legislation is not important. What he said was, it is the implementation of law which is important, and police officers are the law enforcers. So they have to be aware of the challenge coming from a section which has generally been ignored. We have thought wars as being fought on the borders or on an economic front. But this is a war which is being fought from inside. And as the technology grows, as the awareness grows, as the communication increases, improves, the social media's reach improves. It is a very credible threat which Mr. Doval has referred to, that which has to be seen, understood, and counteracted. The reason is, when we say civil society, and I just said it refers to NGOs. And Mr. Doval also said this is one section which can be subverted, manipulated, can be made use of against the national interest. And I don't think there is anything wrong with Mr. Dole's contention. He is just warning the new IPS officers to be aware of these challenges, of which with his vast experience, I think he has had a lot of run-ins with civil society. Maybe that is, he is speaking from his experience. That is all I can say.
Okay, so should I take it NGOs plus activists, some press people, some media people, and all those can be included in this civil society, or maybe some retired judges or bureaucrats also who can influence the government, or they can be the presser, groups, part of the lobbying groups. So I think we should be able to include the entire scenario in that, because इसमें
नहीं,
काफी लोग एक्चुअली इंक्लूड हो जाते
नहीं
हैं.
नहीं ऐसा है. व्हेन वी टॉक ऑफ द पीपल और द इंटरेस्ट ग्रुप्स और द लॉबी ग्रुप्स व्हिच यू आर रेफरिंग टू, ऑफ जजेस, ऑफ रिटायर्ड सिविल सर्वेंट्स, रिटायर्ड पुलिस ऑफिसर्स, रिटायर्ड डिफेंस पर्सनल एंड ऑल, दैट इज जस्ट अ सब सेक्शन ऑफ द बिगर सिविल सोसाइटी.
ओके
And what Mr. Doval referred not to the complete universe of civil society, what he referred to was just a subsection which is hell-bent on subverting the national interest. And
ओके
what he said was, though there As far as the law enforcers are concerned, they have to enforce the law, but also guard the 15,000 kilometers of the boundary of the nation, which he said, not only police, but other police organizations like BSF, CRPF and all are there to help. But internally, within policing domain, it is the IPS officers who will be part of CBI, Intelligence Bureau, NIA, CBI, and so on and so forth, other organizations in the country where their expertise will be used, even cyber law, cyber crimes, cyber espionage, which they have to counter.
Okay. So
his statement was a very overarching statement and sort of a motivation to these young officers to their duties, to motivate them and tell them that their work domain is not limited only to the thanas. It is much beyond the thanas and the police officials.
I got your point. एक बात जानने में इंटरेस्ट रहेगा, हाउ दीज नॉन गवर्नमेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस या जो एक्टिविस्ट हैं या जो भी इसका सिविल सोसाइटी का पार्ट हैं, हाउ दे कैन बी इन्फ्लुएंस्ड बाय आवर एडवर्सरीज?
हाउ कैन दे बी इन्फ्लुएंस्ड बाय आवर एडवर्सरीज?
यस,
बाय मनी, बाय एंटाइसिंग देम थ्रू मनी. सी, recently aware, you might be aware that government had cancelled the licenses of thousands of non-governmental organizations because they were not following the rules under the FCRA. And in under the FCRA, they were getting foreign funds, but they were not reporting it properly and they were not using it for the purpose they had received those funds for. Suppose there's an NGO.
Okay.
XYZ, it gets a fund of $1 million or $2 million for upliftment of girl child, providing education to girl child.
Okay.
Instead of providing that or doing that activity, that particular NGO starts brainwashing college students to take up arms against the government. That is what the leftist organizations, the Maoist organizations are doing. Okay. So, the government stopped the funding because they were not complying with the government regulations.
Okay.
It's as simple as that. So that is one good way to manipulate the civil society, which does not remain civil if it starts doing such things.
So rather than being civil, they become actually uncivil.
Okay. Oh, yes.
Okay. Abhi, jo main TV pe debate dekh raha tha, aur usme kaafi matlab established debaters the, panelists the, you know, डेमोक्रेसी है, जिसको मेजोरिटी मिली उसने गवर्नमेंट बना ली. यू नो, फॉर एग्जांपल मोदी जी ने गवर्नमेंट बना ली, ये बीजेपी की गवर्नमेंट है. कोई भी लॉ पास होता है पार्लियामेंट से, उसके बाद वो इंटरप्रिटेशन के लिए कई बार सुप्रीम कोर्ट जाता है. तो यू नो व्हाट दीज पैनलिस्ट वर सेइंग, कि मेजोरिटी है, आपने पार्लियामेंट के थ्रू कोई भी लॉ बना दिया, सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने भी उसको यस बोल दिया. They must have put certain stipulations, but they have more or less okayed it. Even then, in spite of the fact that total scrutiny has been done, even then, we have got the influence over the society and we should be consulted. It's not that we should not be, we should be, you know, pressurized to agree to whatever the government or, you know, parliament is saying. We have got the power or we have got the influence to interpret it in the interest of the society. Now, is so, that the job of civil society?
No, it is not. They want responsibility without accountability. Why? When there is a system which we have adopted for last 70 years where people elect their representatives and do or make legislations or do work on their behalf, let them do the work. Why did we choose those people? Why did we elect those people? So people who say that they have influence or responsibility, that is what they're doing. They're using their influence for the wrong things, for the wrong objectives. Why should a civil society be always against the government? Then why why do we have government at all? If there is no government, if there is no system of governance, there will be anarchy. And some of these elements of civil society definitely look towards that anarchy. While,
okay,
what is their grievance? I have not had a chance to hear those panelists which you are referring to. If I could get to know the name of the panelists and the matter they were discussing, we can, I think, discuss
it. There is one gentleman, Professor Apurvanan. He teaches Hindi in Delhi University. He was the one actually who referred to this point.
I see. The point is, civil society has definitely a role to play in democracy towards development, toward in the areas where the government cannot reach. Government cannot reach everywhere. And even the civil society cannot reach everywhere. They are basically complementary in the development process. So places where the government finds itself constrained due to the rules, regulations, and resources, it is able to provide those resources, get the volunteers, get people to do things which help in nation building, like the Jal Jeevan Mission. Many of these NGOs from the civil society have been helping. That is a positive contribution. While similarly, the Maoists in the jungles of Madhya Pradesh, they are waging a war, which is quite an uncivil thing. Yes, I'm not contesting their point of view, but from a point of view of a civil society, a society which looks towards development, their actions definitely don't gel in.
Okay, so what is the role of Supreme Court actually? Means, aap agar aap dekho Central Vista project dekho aap, one petition, another petition, followed by another petition. Now you see, they want to have that, you know, roads on the borders. Char Dham project ka part hai wo, but basically it is basically for border management. So, वहाँ पे, you know, again the fight is on in the Supreme Court. So किसी ने किसी को तो ultimately आके उनको एक बार को ये तो बताना पड़ेगा कि भाई आपका ये रोल नहीं है कि आप देश की सिक्योरिटी के अगेंस्ट में जाएं या कंट्री के कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के अगेंस्ट में जाएं. Means for everything they have got a petition in the Supreme Court or the High Court. After all, ultimately क्या सारे एनजीओ इसी कैटेगरी में हैं कि यू नो ऐसा लगता है कई बार को तो जैसे वो पूरे एक एंटी नेशनल और एंटी गवर्नमेंट प्रोफाइल में है. क्या ये जरूरी है कि एनजीओ को गवर्नमेंट के अगेंस्ट में ही होना है? और सुप्रीम कोर्ट का क्या रोल है?
नहीं, माय व्यू इज देयर आर थाउजेंड्स ऑफ एनजीओस. इट्स ओनली अ हैंडफुल ऑफ एनजीओस व्हिच ट्राई टू क्रिएट ट्रबल, व्हिच ट्राई टू इंटरवीन इन any developmental activity. How can a nation develop? As you just mentioned, Char Dham project, we may call it Char Dham project, but it is basically a project to provide roads in the sensitive border areas. It connects Char Dham. That is another thing, that is just an offshoot of the original borders project. And what exactly is their contention? I know that, but I just wanted to hear it from you.
वो एनवायरमेंटल डिग्रेडेशन, ये तो बड़ा स्टैंडर्ड सा है. और इवन जो सेंट्रल विस्टा प्रोजेक्ट है उसका भी उन्होंने कहा कि जो पुरानी जो हमारी हेरिटेज है वो खत्म होगी एंड ऑल दैट. द पॉइंट जो मुझे लगता है ना, और कि किसने किसी तरीके से प्रोजेक्ट्स को डिले करना है, तो ये मेरे को आर्ग्यूमेंट समझ नहीं आता कि अल्टीमेटली दे नो दैट गवर्नमेंट विल गेट द यस, बट दे वांट टू बाई टाइम एंड टाइम. तो उसमें कई बार मेरे को उनके इंटेंशंस पे डाउट होता है.
नहीं नहीं, आपको बिल्कुल उनके इंटेंशंस पे जो डाउट हो रहा है, ठीक डाउट हो रहा है, उसमें कोई दिक्कत नहीं. उनका काम ही उस प्रोजेक्ट को डिले कराना होता है. एंड व्हाट दे अचीव, आई डोंट नो. आई हैव नॉट बीन एबल टू फैथम एज टू व्हाई दे वांट टू गेट इट डिलेड. सी, अल्टीमेटली गवर्नमेंट इज अ पावरफुल एंटिटी. इट हैज टेकन इनटू कंसिडरेशन मेनी ऑफ दोज ऑब्जेक्शंस. इट हैज पुट रेमेडियल मेजर्स इनटू प्लेस. व्हाई डोंट वी सी दैट? एंड having a project for the development of the country cannot always be against environment, cannot always be against the ethos. If these activists or these people who file the PILs are so concerned, why don't they go in the field and do and see the work themselves? Baith ke एसी कमरों में बैठ के कथा बांचना बहुत आसान है, गांव में जाके अगर कहा जो रोड्स की बात कर रहे हैं उत्तराखंड में अगर कोई ट्रैवल करे है ना, सबसे पहले यही लोग होंगे जो कहेंगे कि वहां रोड बननी चाहिए, इज इट नॉट सो?
यस,
कनेक्टिविटी एंड एक्सपेंसेस ऑन रोड्स ब्रिजेस एंड सच इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर कैन नॉट बी मेजर्ड इन वन जनरेशन इन वन लाइफ टाइम. See, I have done studies when we were funding the infrastructure projects,
okay,
where we tried to find out the viability of a bridge or a small village road, just a 2 kilometer road, all weather metal topped road. If we are able to get it, saves hundreds of lives, it provides employment to hundreds of people, mobility increases, health facilities are available. People are able to market their produce, whatever produce they produce in their vicinity, handicrafts, crops, or whatever.
And okay,
world over, it has been accepted that connectivity, here we are talking of roads, it can be rail, it can be planes like the Udaan Yojana, everything adds to the economic activity. And we have to accept a very learned economist had said the very existence of human being is dangerous to environment. So will these NGOs start eliminating human beings?
Okay, well, tell me one thing. Why they are so selective? You know, we have seen at the time of CA, anti-CA agitation, and we have seen it in Assam and against NRC. Why they are so selective in their approach? Means, are they getting the funds just to do that? And are there any NGOs or activists, for that matter, who take contrary opinion? Or they all are in one group only?
The point is, what we are seeing is just the rogue elements. And just because of these rogue elements, the complete civil society gets tarnished. These people get press, these people get coverage, and these people get money and other resources. There are hundreds and thousands of NGOs who are doing good work at the ground level, providing education, providing logistics, providing health services, providing nutritional services, and so on and so forth. It is only a few handful who don't actually contribute to the national building, except for countering the arguments. Yes, their arguments may be of use. It gives a second opinion. It gives a second dimension, which the policy planners ideally should consider and amend the project or the policies to the benefit of the bigger society. See, there is one point. If we have accepted democracy, we cannot talk about majoritarianism and so on, so-called concepts. Because these civil society people, they talk of majoritarianism or what we call as authoritarian government. What is authoritarian? Rule of the majority is the very crux of democracy. Either you don't have democracy. If you don't have democracy, you'll have dictatorships. You'll have oligarchies. So democracy is the best of evil or the best of the worst. And there is nothing like the best across the world. Be it capitalism, be it communism, be it what we call as the kingdoms, or so and so forth, whatever.
Okay, but you know that charge is already coming that India is going to be, you know, they have correlated Doval's statement with India becoming a policy state, and it is subjugation of democracy, and we are going to get the authoritarian regime. It is already there. So we actually are getting all those feelers, but ultimately, what is the way out?
Have you heard of a gentleman called Snowden?
Yeah, of course.
Where has he been hiding?
Russia only.
No, Snowden is hiding from the police forces of United States of America for last 10 years or 12 years.
Right? Ah, he was in Russia.
And why is he hiding? Because he leaked some official documents or the papers which he had access to on the internet, right? He wanted to be one of the biggest do-gooders of this world. Fine. Why is he not returning to his own motherland, his own country? Because he will be prosecuted.
Yes.
So if somebody breaks the law, they have to face the law. It's as simple as that.
Yeah.
So authoritarianism is just a viewpoint. From the point of view of governance, from the point of view of a government, it is a strong government or governance structure. From the point of view of those people who are being prosecuted, it is being authoritarian. What is authoritarian? Does it mean that I have the right when I say freedom of speech? Let us take freedom of speech.
Yeah, freedom of speech. Yes.
Freedom of speech. Do I have a right to say anything and everything which I want, whether it be right, whether it be wrong, whether it be an allegation which ultimately may tarnish somebody's image, may hurt somebody's business, may hurt somebody's reputation? That is not freedom of speech. Freedom of speech has reasonable riders. I cannot go out and call somebody in the judiciary or hired judiciary and by name and say that so-and-so is aligned with so-and-so and he's taking money without any proof. If I have proof, yes, I should. If I don't have any proof, I need to shut up and bear with the system.
Yes, so ultimately, what is going to be the solution? The point is,
solution is,
first of all, will India be a police state?
Did India become a police state in 1975? India's strong polity, strong democratic credentials. I'm very hopeful that India will not become a police state.
Okay. So,
and these are basically fears of the mind. See, we started using electronic voting machines during Congress regime. Mr. T.N. Seshan was the one who pushed it forward.
Yes.
Now, if some other government has been elected through fair means, why do we blame the machine? So, and when the same machine is used in Rajasthan or in Chhattisgarh and the other parties win, do we use the same argument there? That is what civil society is doing. And that's absurd to say that these machines are being... I'm just giving an example of freedom of speech. Freedom of speech does not mean to make allegations endlessly. When the election commission invited these parties to come and demonstrate if there is any vulnerability, where were they? Why didn't they come forward?
Okay.
And when they won in Delhi, twice in Delhi state, the electronic voting machines got their own mind and they elected somebody who is not authoritarian, who is not XYZ, and who is a very civil person.
Okay.
For argument's sake, we can keep on going. But then, if a country has to work, if governance has to progress, there will always be different opinions in democracy. But to a reasonable limit, that's all.
So
India will, I don't know what will happen, but to me, given the situation, I don't think India will be a police state. It can be a chaotic state, it can be in anarchy, that may be there, but not a police state.
This is one very, important point. You know, these civil society, they always talk of the human rights violation by the security forces, by the state police and all such organizations. But they never bother about the human rights of the security forces. Last time, if you remember, there was an incident in Kashmir Valley in which, you know, this video was viral. The boy, it was just a 8 or 9 years old boy, he was kicking a CRPF guy. So you will not find them making any statement after the incidents like this. In the same way, they try to find the faults with our fault lines. You know, if there is a question of a minority, they will be, hammer and tong. There is a question of Dalit, they will make lot of noise. I'm not saying they are wrong. They are good enough. But my point is, why they are so selective about it and why they are always looking for our fault lines, which probably does not require that much attention, because as a country, we are supposed to look at the positive aspects also. So what is your opinion about it?
अगर हमारी फॉल्ट लाइन नहीं देखेंगे तो किसकी देखेंगे लोग? अगर उत्पात मचाना है तो उत्पात मचाने के लिए तो फॉल्ट लाइन ही देखनी पड़ेगी, और लैप्सिस अगर कहीं हो भी गए उसको मैग्निफाइन करके प्रोटेक्ट वो करना है. सी आर सिक्योरिटी फोर्सेस वर्क इन अ वेरी डिफिकल्ट सिचुएशन, देयर हैंड्स गेट टाइट एट दिस सिचुएशन एंड यू हैव बीन इन द फोर्सेस. इफ अ डिसीजन हैज टू बी टेकन, इट हैज टू बी टेकन इन अ स्प्लिट सेकेंड. There was an incident where they had stopped a car, or they had let the car go without checking, and it contained a bomb. It was the security forces again who were blamed. So maybe because of the difficult situation and so much loss of life, our security forces have become a little too cautious. They can be at loss of decision, because if they shoot, they are damned. If they don't shoot, they are damned. The point is, there was a case where the security, I think it was the army personnel, who had taken some action, and they a case was registered against them, and they were in jail for nearly 6-7 years.
Yes.
And that acts as a demoralizing action on the other security forces. So human rights is a very convenient stick to beat anybody with. Why don't these people talk of human rights in the US? Why don't these people talk of the human rights in China, where hundreds and thousands of citizens are being held captive in some provinces? And why don't these civil society people talk of human rights in Afghanistan, where innocent men, women, and children are being slaughtered? They're not being killed, they're being slaughtered.
Yes.
There's a difference between killing and slaughter. So, as far as security forces are concerned, they may be high-handed. I accept that. I'm not saying they are clean or they are, everything is by protocol. But even the judiciary, even the civil society, they have to see the difficult circumstances they work in. Anybody who says that, they are all of them, it's not all of them. There may be one or two rogue elements, maybe one or two rogue incidents, they've blown up. Had our security forces not been very alert, not been very proactive, we would not have been able to prevent so many of these incidents, especially around our Independence Day, around major festivals, and so on and so forth. So, ये तो बड़ी पुरानी डिबेट है ह्यूमन राइट्स की. सबसे आसान तरीका है किसी भी उसको जनरलाइज करके कि ह्यूमन राइट्स हो गए वायलेट. आई से माय ह्यूमन राइट्स गेट्स वायलेटेड व्हेन अ बॉम्बर और अ जिहादी ब्लोज हिमसेल्फ अप.
यस,
उसका कोई जवाब नहीं है, है ना?
Yes.
तो इसलिए इस तरह की डिबेट तो डेमोक्रेसी में चलती रहेंगी.
Okay.
इसमें कोई दो राय नहीं है, बट वी शुड टेक विद अ पिंच ऑफ सॉल्ट, एंड इफ देयर इज एनी इश्यू व्हिच इज बीइंग रेज्ड, वी शुड नॉट ब्रश इट अवे. आई एम सेइंग इन्वेस्टिगेट इट, एंड आफ्टर इन्वेस्टिगेशन एवरीबॉडी शुड बी एबल टू एक्सेप्ट दैट. जरूरी नहीं है कि हर बार वो गलत ही निकले, या जरूरी नहीं है हर बार सही निकले. अगर इफ वी हैव फेथ इन आवर जुडिशियरी और द प्रोसेस, देन वी शुड एक्सेप्ट द जजमेंट्स व्हाट एवर दे आर. वी कैन नॉट गो एंडलेसली.
Yes, I agree with you.
So, there has to be a closure.
Absolutely. And, you know, we ought to have the faith in our process, in our country, in our security agency, in our system. Because everything, right. You can't say that, you know, just because I'm running NGO, I'm the most, you know, sincere and India-friendly person, and I can sit over the Supreme Court or probably over the laws.
The point is, we must accept that we are living in a very imperfect world. We are not living in utopia. Utopia mein hota tab dekhenge. But filhal jo imperfections hai, we have to live with the imperfections. And current system is more or less acceptable with all these imperfections and difficulties.
Okay. So thank you, Neeraj. It's really a wonderful point which has come up. Thank you so much. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you for watching. I will see you in next video.